What does conservatism mean? Today it seems to mean three things. Low taxes, to use an American term, small government, or at least smaller than the opposition, and to coin an extremely non-catchy phrase, whatever nextism. In 2000, then Conservative candidate for Witney, David Cameron, attacked repeatedly the Labour government's plans to abolish Section 28, publicly criticising then Prime Minister Tony Blair as being anti-family and accusing him of wanting the promotion of homosexuality in schools. Whatever next, you can almost hear him cry. Gay marriage? Well, guess who it was in 2009, formally apologising for his party's introduction of the law, stating that it was a mistake, had been offensive to gay people, and proposing to alter Conservative Party policy to reflect his belief that equality should be embedded in British schools, basically enacting what he accused the Labour Party of less than 10 years earlier? Yep, that's right, then leader of the Conservative Party, David Cameron. And to put the cherry on top, his was the government to legalise same-sex marriage in 2012. At the time of the 2005 general election, Michael Howard, then leader of the Conservative Party, who also previously supported Section 28, commented that Section 28 was brought in to deal with what was seen to be a specific problem at the time. The problem was that the kind of literature that was being used in some schools and distributed to very young children that was seen to promote homosexuality. I thought, rightly or wrongly, that there was a problem in those days. That problem simply doesn't exist now. Nobody's fussed about those issues anymore. It's not a problem, so the law shouldn't be hanging around the statute book. The Conservatives once argued that homosexuality was wrong and should be punished. A view that I only half agree with, but that was their view nonetheless. Then the position became after the introduction of Section 28, a law that prohibited the promotion of homosexuality, that homosexuality should be legal, but it should be illegal to promote or publicly display it. This was pretty much in line with the public view of the time. In 1987, the year before the legislation was enacted, the British Social Attitude Survey found that 75% of the population said that homosexuality was always or mostly wrong, with just 11% believing it to be never wrong. But alas, as I've pointed out, the Conservative position changed again in the mid-2000s, after a brief battle within the Conservative Party, to the position it's okay to have public displays of homosexuality, but homosexuals aren't allowed to get married. I think you get the picture. I think as soon as something horrifically left-wing is on the table, then it's pretty much guaranteed to happen and be a so-called Conservative position within a relatively short space of time. It feels like at the moment we are living in the world of whatever next. Whatever next is now. And this is because the so-called right is basically just following behind the left by a few years, and not enforcing their own will or simply just capitulating when they get into positions of power, meaning that Cthulhu is always swimming left. Despite this, I still consider myself to be a conservative. François-René de Chateaubriand perhaps described conservatism best as the power of great epic writers, nature in its great diversity and grandeur, the poetry of ruins, the spell of the distant past, the beauty of immemorial popular rituals, and the haunting melancholy of music, the pangs of awakening consciousness, and the perils and ardours of the solitary adolescent soul. Roger Scruton said that our existence as citizens freely participating in a state is made possible by our enduring attachments to the things that we hold dear. Our condition is not homo economicus, searching in everything to satisfy private desires. We are home-building creatures cooperating in the search for intrinsic values. As I saw Sojourner point out on the day, the links between the church and the state that once existed more candidly in days gone by, that were displayed for old time's sake for the funeral of Prince Philip, God rest his soul, are basically at the core of what this country is. Unlike the United States, we are officially an Anglican Christian country. The Queen is the head of the church and the Archbishop of Canterbury has special duties, like crowning the monarch. I spoke about this last video and I don't want to sound like a broken record, but without a muscular Christianity that we can derive collective morality from, we are vulnerable to moral slips. Christianity says homosexuality is morally wrong. We are a Christian country, and that should be the end of it. As always, Peter Hitchens can put it better than me.
This country ceased to be truly Christian in terms of people genuinely, consciously, and in an educated way believing in the Christian faith after the First World War. People still continue to behave as if they're Christians. The society continues to function as if it's a Christian society for some time after it's gone. We've been living in the past 40 or 50 years in the afterglow of Christianity, but eventually the darkness falls.
Nick Fuentes, in a Q&A session he took part in, gave a good historical example of the battle between the John Birch Society, which was traditionalist, nationalist, paleoconservative, etc., and the National Review, which was made up partly of Randian libertarians, and also partly of centre-left types that split with the rest of the left, over interventionism, over who would become the dominant force in conservatism. No prizes for guessing which one won there, although it must be said a significant paleoconservative presence does still exist in the States. Back over the pond to Britain, a similar battle did take place, although it was more of a slow shift in ideology. You could drag this all the way back to Robert Peel distancing himself from the paternalistic conservatism of the Duke of Wellington in the mid-19th century in favour of what was for the time quite a liberal agenda. It was said by former Labour Prime Minister Harold Wilson that the Conservative Monday Club, which was a nationalist and traditionalist group within the Conservative Party that were willing to touch on controversial issues and were in favour of offering voluntary repatriation to ethnic minorities, was the guardian of the Tory conscience. The cornerstone group within the Conservative Party, which I think has some MPs that are worth supporting, such as former Monday Club member Andrew Rossendall, who coincidentally used to follow Master Brew on Twitter, has in their manifesto what I would perhaps call a rare glimpse of the true form of conservatism. We believe that these values must be stressed. Tradition, nation, family, religious ethics, free enterprise. We must seize the centre ground and pull it kicking and screaming towards us. That is the only way to demolish the foundations of the liberal establishment and demonstrate to the electorate the fundamental flaws on which it is based. Now that's more like it. We live in a country with a two-party political system. The only way historically that power has ever been leveraged in this system is through the two largest political parties, or in one case partly through the third largest party, the Liberal Democrats, although I don't think that will happen again, and once partly through the DUP, which are the largest party in Northern Ireland. The only exception is UKIP, and even then their influence came from forcing the Tories' hands on the European issue over fear of lost votes, and I'm not even sure if that could happen again without European elections, which elect candidates proportionally. Ataman gave some anecdotal evidence on a stream I was on with 99 Iron Duke, whose channel you should sub to by the way, that Tory establishment types were worried about what was then termed the High Tory Gang, which was basically just a load of Twitter accounts and people making meme videos, as they thought that them encouraging entryism into the Conservative Party could lead to a lurch to the right in the Tory Party. For those in the know, that ended for various different reasons. So the problem now, therefore, is a lack of public espousal of traditionalist conservatism or High Toryism. Other than a few people and organisations who have come about quite recently, including The Mallard, whose first print magazine I'm enjoying very much by the way, and a handful of people in 2018. This ideological position hasn't been very well represented, either online or in the political discourse generally. With the sad death of Sir Roger Scruton last year, it felt like something else died with him, an almost gentlemanly conservatism. That is specifically and unmistakably British, that gives not just meaning in terms of identity, but also spiritual guidance where the modern world is clearly lacking. This has led many people who feel beaten down by the instruments of our modern society to take up a rather different ideological position because they have no political home. This position will frankly never bear fruit. As soon as normal-ish people hear some of the stuff you are coming out with, they are going to hear Messerschmitts flying over their heads. No political solution? Well, not if you're a Nazi. In any case, a true conservative party, I think, is the natural home for any self-respecting right-winger. Where we can say we don't want Thai food in our pub in Shropshire, for example, we'd rather have cured ham. If we wanted Thai food, we'd go to Thailand. The thinnest wedge of identitarianism is really all you need in this case. It's not that there is a lot of competition on that front. If you go out and be out and out openly racist, sexist, Islamophobic, etc., people will flat out reject you. Not only that, they will fight you. I actively try and make this channel not about my disagreements with the far right, and this will probably be the last time I discuss it, as I don't think they are, to be honest, a very big target, and I'm happy like I am with people like Sargon and Paul Joseph Watson, just for them to stick to their lane. I think a lot of people are waiting, though, for something that is right-wing, pro-British, and strongly differentiated from that kind of politics. Will that ever come along? I'm hopeful that the beginning of the vanguard of it is beginning to appear over the horizon. I am reminded of the words of Winston Churchill. We await until
in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
Thank you for watching. A like would be appreciated. Please subscribe if you haven't, and I'll see you soon. Bye.